Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I am Dr. Mohiuddin Mirza, your host for the program Food for Thought. I hope you have been enjoying our different program. We have talked on a variety of subjects. This time, we are very honored and very excited that we are bringing a wonderful friend of ours, Dr. Ibrahim Abu Rabi. And the subject is going to be, which you probably never thought that closely, what's going on around us in the world. Especially the recent news from, it started with Egypt, for example, and then Syria is in the news and Libya is in the news. Then Western powers are getting involved as well. What implication it has got for us? Many times we are too comfortable in our own homes and don't realize that global incidents have a direct or indirect impacts on our lives in many ways. And Dr. Abu Rabi, mashallah, has a lot of experience with this one. He's a professor of Islamic Studies, University of Alberta. So let's talk with him. Dr. Abu Rabi, thank you very much for joining
thank
us.
You. Thank
I
you. I
notice here that you are a professor right now, an ECMC chair in Islamic Studies. ECMC, Edmonton Council of Muslim
Communities.
Yeah. So when did you join the University of Alberta?
I came to the University of Alberta 3 years ago from the States. I used to live in the States for like
But looks like I've known you for 20 years.
That's right. It's mainly because one dimension of my work would be to work with the Muslim communities here.
Right.
Different communities, including the Ahmadi community as well.
Right, yes. Exactly. Yeah. A little bit of your own background. You were a professor in U.S. as well?
I was a professor of Islamic Studies and Christian-Muslim Relations in Hartford Seminary in Hartford, Connecticut.
Right.
And as a matter of fact, the first Center for the Study of Islam and Christian-Muslim Relations was established in the USA in Hartford Seminary in 1892, in the 19th century.
Right.
And I used to be the chief editor of the Muslim World, which is a well-known journal.
Right, right.
It's the first journal in the USA in the study of Islam and Muslim thought.
Right, right.
So I decided to forego that, and I came to Canada 3 years ago. I teach now at the University of Alberta, as you said. I like my teaching here. The students are pretty excellent. In addition, the other dimension of working with the Muslim communities in the city as well as in Alberta.
Right. And your political thought process, I have always enjoyed talking to you, the depth and wisdom you provide on the global situation. But before we talk about global circumstances, you were born in Nazareth in Palestine?
Yes, I am Palestinian. I was born in Nazareth, which is not from Al-Kababir, from Haifa. And I used to know the Ahmadi community in Haifa when I was in high school.
Right.
You know, I always wanted to know more about the Muslim world because I come
from
a small minority within Israel.
Right.
And that's why part of my education when I got out to the States 25 years ago to study, I decided to study not only what we call Islamic theology and Islamic studies, but also the Muslim world, the history of the modern Muslim world, Islamic movements and contemporary. And it's really fascinating to combine what we call Islamic theology with the history of the modern Muslim world.
Right, right.
I've been to Pakistan many times, to India at least 18 times.
Really?
I lived in Indonesia for 2 years, Malaysia.
Right.
So I have a perspective on the contemporary Muslim world.
Right, and that's a very important thing
that
with your own experience and how you analyze it. You mentioned that this morning you had an article in Edmonton Journal as well.
Yeah, I wrote an article about the current situation in Syria because I've
been
to Syria so many times. And as you well know, I invited the Mufti of Damascus
he has
last year. You met him to come here. He's been here twice.
Right.
So it's very important to speak about the current situation in Syria as well because
The
whole, you know, the revolt began initially in Tunisia last year, at the end of last year. Then from Tunisia it went to Egypt, from Egypt to Libya, Yemen, Bahrain, and now Syria. So the question is, what's going on? What is unifying to all of these countries?
Exactly,
nowadays?
And that's what we'd like to know, because many times people like me and many others who are our listener, they're so busy in their daily lives that they don't get a perspective that where does the oil politics come in, for example?
Of course, oil politics is a significant idea that I'd like to talk about a bit later. But let's talk about one significant angle that many commentators in the mass media have not talked about, which is demography.
Right.
You know, like Egypt nowadays is a country with a population of 85 million people.
Okay.
But in 1960, 50 years ago, Egypt had only 22 million people.
Hmm.
In the same case, when Syria became independent in 1946 from the French, Syria had only 3.5 million people, but today they are 24 million people. So there's a demographic factor, and where, you know, there's a major fact that most of the population is very young in the Muslim world.
If
we talk about the Arab world, the Arab world is extremely young. And most of the population has been born in the past 20 or 25 years.
So these are young people who are coming in.
They are young people with high expectations. Many of them are educated. And that's why they feel that the political system of the country or the education system does not fit their own expectations and demands. And I believe that this is one significant factor in the current uprisings in the Arab world is the demographic factor. Before we can talk about Western intervention in Libya, let's say, or Bahrain or whatever, the demographic factor, to my mind, is a significant factor that has been overlooked.
And you're very right. This has been overlooked. Any commentator I have seen, they are making it more like a Muslim, Islamic, insurgency type situation, but this point has not been mentioned.
Of course, I believe that Islam has something to do with that, but I think that what is more significant is the demographic factor, the fact that we have lots of young people who are highly educated and who are not satisfied with the current political status quo as well as with the education.
And even the jobs and the education.
With jobs, with the economy, because everything is intertwined, as you will know. Economy, politics, religion, society, culture, as well as the relationship between the Muslim world and the West. That's another dimension, too, that we have to look at.
So let's start with the Tunisia. That Tunisia came first in the news.
Yes.
What happened there? What's the let's say geography, not geography, but in the situation that population-wise, Muslims, Christians, how is Tunisia?
As you well know, Tunisia had been colonized by the French until 1956.
Okay, I see,
And when Habib Bourguiba came to power in 1956, he came on the ticket of nationalism and the construction of a democratic, secular nation state. But he somewhat failed, and also the regime, the Ben Ali regime that came after him. Tunisia is located, as you will know, between Algeria to the west and Libya to the east in North Africa. Tunisia has a small population of 6 to 7 million people, most of whom are Muslim.
So it's a much smaller country.
It's a very small country. In addition, it had been colonized by the French for at least 80 or 90 years. In the case of Algeria, it had been colonized for 150 years or so until 1962. So there was, you know, there was a secular, westernized, francophone intelligentsia in the Tunisian case that, to my mind, has failed to build the foundation of a secular nation state, a state that would be, in a sense, fair to all of its citizens. Of course, the different Islamic movements were persecuted in Tunisia, but I think that it is mainly, you know, the lack of meeting the demands and the expectations of the youth in Tunisian society. And I don't think that most of the youth in the Tunisian case or in the Algerian case or the Egyptian or Yemeni, I don't think that they belong to particular religious parties or movements. But that doesn't mean that they are not religious. Many of them are, you know, good Muslims and all of that.
That's true, yeah.
But I think that the major factor behind this is the absence of economic equity in their own societies.
So this is a very strong message and opinion as well, that the economics is playing a much bigger role and dominating. Basically, all the analysts are saying that the religion and the other factor. So economics,
of course, religion has something to do with all of that. You know, if you take the case, you know, let's talk a bit about the case of Egypt, because that's a very interesting case. As you well know, the major official establishment in Egypt is the Azhar University, the Azhar establishment.
And it has been there for a long time?
It has been there for the past 1,000 years or so. Al-Azhar was established in the 10th century. By the Fatimid Empire in Cairo. They built Cairo in 996, and Al-Azhar was built 2 years later, in 998. But the point here is that Al-Azhar is has been, for at least 800 years, the official Sunni Muslim institution in the Muslim world. And as you well know, most of the ulama, or the mullah of Al-Azhar, they have supported the different government. Let's say the Farouk monarchy before 1952, then the Nasser regime after between 52 and 1970, then Sadat between 70 and 81, then Mubarak between 81 until a few months ago. Whereas if you look at the, you know, different religious forces in society, you could talk about the Salafi Wahhabis in Egypt. You you could talk about the Ikhwan or the Muslim Brotherhood movement.
You could
talk about Sufis. You could talk about Muslims who are not political in nature.
That's true. Yeah,
because
yeah.
we have all sorts of yeah. Muslims in terms of their own stance on politics.
So,
to say that religion has a lot to do means that we're talking about religion in a monolithic sense.
That's right, yeah.
Because
yeah,
we
yeah,
need to yeah, understand yeah, the different right, social and religious forces in Egyptian society or Tunisian society.
But what motivates young people then to come out on the street to give their message? Why couldn't it be accomplished by normal means, which we are used to hear?
I'll tell you this. You know, if you look at the history of the modern nation state in all of these countries, because all of these countries became independent roughly 50 years ago or 60 years ago,
and they were all colonial. You said Tunisia was under
colonized by the French,
and
Egypt by the British.
British.
I mean, the British colonization was not as severe as the French of Tunisia.
Right.
But the British were there roughly until 1952. But the point here is that when the nation state began to take shape in the 1950s and the 1960s, the nation state began to strike or to write down a contract, in a sense, between the regime and the people. But the nation state failed in its modernization program like 10 or 20 years after the establishment of the nation state. That's to say that the contract between the state and the people fell down. It was broken. And that's why people reacted to that in a severe way. But it took them 20 or 30 years to react. People do not react all of a sudden. Millions of people. It's because this frustration has accumulated over, I would say, at least 20 years, if not 30 years. Because of the failure of the modern nation state to build a good economy, to build a good educational system, to satisfy the youth in their society, and also to create a balance between religion and state in their societies. And that's
we are going to continue with the question that what makes young youth, you're mentioning that is the youth group which is coming out, and most of the analysts have not touched too much on that, the economic factor, a new generation has grown up. So what motivates them to come out on the street?
As I said, you know, it's mainly the demographic factor that, you know, these countries have multiplied in population over the past 50 years. Most of these youth have been born in the past 20 to 30 years. And they have huge expectations of their governments and states and their societies. Because many of them are highly educated women and men. And that's why, you know, they feel and think that the ruling system is defunct, it's a matter of the past, that there needs some renewal and revival, which is the norm in any human society.
But that also brings up the point that these leadership question, leadership issues, that simply the government could not provide resources and both material or education to these youths, but they're amassing their own wealth in such a large number.
You know, I think that I do agree with you, but I think that we need to draw a distinction between what we call regimes and states. That these regimes, you know, many of these in the Arab world are either family-based or tribe-based. They are not based on the concept of the whole state. Whereas with the new independent nation states in the 1940s or 50s, the leaders cared about the nation, not about their own tribe in specific. Whereas it seems that tribalism has been revived in a major way, even in the so-called secular democratic republican system, such as in Tunisia or Egypt or Libya. You know, if we take the Libyan case, you know, it's very clear that it is a tribal war also. Also a regional war between different regions in the country. And I wonder how come that in 42 years of power that Muammar Gaddafi and his regime had not been able to unify the tribes and give them a vision of a unity, national unity. On the contrary, what we see nowadays is a major division and polarization in Libyan society, which means that his own vision and plan had been a major failure in the past. Although, you know, Libya does have the money out of petroleum to create that unified vision. But because the regime has become very small and tribal-based, if not family-based, they have failed to create that unified vision and to take care of the needs of their own people, different regions in the country, and so on.
Let's go back to Egypt. We talked briefly about their president had billions of dollars stacked up somewhere. What I find so intriguing is that the Western powers, all these people have investment in the West. Most of the banking is done right here. They have bought big buildings, big properties.
Exactly.
Do they think that they're going to live forever? Or what their needs are?
It's amazing. Yeah, I mean, they know rationally that they are transient human beings
because
they come from an Islamic tradition.
Right.
This is very big in Islam that all of us are transient human beings.
Exactly,
we're not going to live forever.
Exactly.
But I think that these people are very scared of the loss of wealth because some of them come from humble backgrounds, like Mubarak. He came from a poor family.
Right.
Then he rose up in the hierarchy.
Right.
But there's another point, you know, just in terms of the Western attitude that I'm sure we'll talk about more, that when President Obama went to Cairo a year and a half ago and he gave the famous Cairo address to the Muslim world out of Cairo, his idea was to support democracy and democratic movements in the Arab and the Muslim world.
Right. Yeah.
But many of these youths have become disenchanted with American foreign policy because they feel that Americans just talk about democracy, but they don't practice democracy in the Muslim world.
Yeah. And that's the excuse me. That's where the politics of oil also come in. That why the Western powers, who are the major users of oil. Is that the oil is the reason they are interested in
it? Of course, oil is very significant as a foreign policy tool to the West.
Right.
You know, if we look at the Gulf states, it's very clear that the Saudi intervention in Bahrain by sending Saudi troops to Bahrain would not have taken place if the Saudis did not have a green light from the USA to intervene.
Yes,
which means that this is a clear signal from the West, in particular from the USA, that the US wants the Gulf states to be stable, to preserve stability, except perhaps in the case of Yemen, because Yemen does not have petroleum, or not in the same amounts as Saudi Arabia or Abu Dhabi or Kuwait or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's very clear that the West wants stability in the Gulf states.
Right.
But of course, you know, in the Gulf, we have different forces.
Yeah.
We have, let's say, the Arab Gulf states, we have Iraq, we have Iran, we have the West, we have also South Asia, because South Asia is pretty close to the Gulf.
Right. Yeah.
So we have different forces in the Gulf.
Right. Right.
And, you know, many people say, for example, and I'm not sure about this point, that Iran wants to destabilize the Gulf.
Yeah.
But it's very clear that everybody is nervous about the current situation. Iranians and non-Iranians and Arabs are extremely nervous about the current revolts because no one knows what future the Middle East holds for the people of the Middle East.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So talking a little bit more on Egypt, I know we did touch a little bit on the history of Egypt as a civilization. No, if you look at a civilization, that you are saying that Al-Azhar University started when?
In the 10th century, years ago. Yeah.
And that was a seat of learning for a lot of people.
Yes, of course, you know, as you well know, Al-Azhar University was built by the Fatimid Shiite Empire, Ismaili Empire, in the 10th century.
Right.
In 998, after the building of Cairo, Al-Qahira in Arabic.
Yeah,
And then Salah ad-Din in the 11th century made it a Sunni capital.
But
nevertheless, you know, Cairo has been a center of culture, civilization, education for many people from the Muslim world.
Right,
you know, if you go to Al-Azhar University nowadays in Cairo, it has 400,000 students. Most of whom are foreign students from Malaysia.
400,000?
400. It's a lot of students. Mm. Who study Arabic and Islamic sciences and other sciences and all of that.
Right.
So Cairo has been very significant, not only for the Arab world, but for the Muslim world as well.
Right.
And you know, if you have a degree from Al-Azhar, you are called an Azharite.
Exactly.
You know, it's like going to Princeton or Yale or Columbia or Harvard.
So what's your thinking now? What's going to happen? Now, Egypt apparently, the revolution or whatever has been successful from a Western viewpoint.
Yeah.
Few people were killed, but Mubarak was disposed of or whatever. Can a good governance could come so the stability in that region?
Of course, that's an excellent point. I mean, the point here is that Egyptians are aware of this.
Right.
Is how to rewrite the Egyptian constitution in a way that is fair to all of the citizens of Egypt, Muslims and Copts.
Right, right.
Because the people in power in Egypt, they don't want any sectarian conflict.
Right,
and sadly, there was some. There has been some sectarian conflict in Egypt,
especially
in the Egyptian countryside. But this is against the ethics of Islam or Christianity.
Exactly. Yeah,
because Muslims and Christians in Egypt have coexisted as Muslims and Christians since the beginning of Islam, peacefully.
Right, exactly.
So now they want to rewrite the Egyptian constitution. Mm. they want to rewrite, you know, the rules of a new governance system in
right,
Egypt.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They want to establish a new government that would be democratic in nature,
yeah.
where they would have free elections and all of that.
Right, right.
And above all, they would need also to rebuild the economy. We must not forget that
exactly,
point.
Exactly, yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
it would take the Egyptians, I would say, at least 10 years to heal the Egyptian economy.
Exactly, yeah.
Because
yeah.
the last regime and the regime before had stolen so much money.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was only a small minority of people.
Yeah, yeah.
But the Egyptian economy is for the Egyptians, not only for the one percenters in society.
Right, exactly, yeah. yeah.
And the youth will have a major say to say they will have a major role to play
right.
in the new Egyptian government, in the Egyptian economy, in the globalization of Egyptian ideas and culture, in
right.
the mass media.
Right.
So the youth are pretty active, and as a matter of fact, you know, it's like, you know, we have watched the news, Al Jazeera and all of that,
right. yeah.
and
yeah.
we
yeah.
could see the power of the youth, but
yeah.
if we were inside Egyptian society, we could see that those youth, or some of them, were highly organized, they
yeah.
knew what they wanted.
Yeah.
Most of them were not affiliated with a particular political
party
or religious
yeah.
party.
Yeah, right, yeah, yeah.
They want the best for their own society,
yeah,
and that's
yeah.
why they staged that revolt
right,
against
right.
an entrenched regime. And
yeah.
the regime, you know, luckily for them and perhaps for us,
right,
was
yeah.
able to go,
yeah, yeah.
went away.
Right.
And nowadays, you know, the major task is multifold that faces the youth in Egyptian
but
society.
Do you think some good leadership will also emerge in...
I think that, yes, yes. You know, every nation has its own good
exactly,
leaders, of
yeah,
course.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Egypt has a number of sophisticated people,
mm-hmm.
and the youth, you know, let's not forget that when Nasser, let's say, came to power
yeah,
in 1952,
yeah. Yeah.
he was only 32 years old. He was very young at the time, and he was a military officer, as you well know.
Right, right.
I don't know what type of education he had, only an Egyptian
yeah,
education.
Yeah, yeah.
But most of these youth are highly educated. Some of them are westernized in their own education.
Right, right.
And they have the vision for a better Egyptian society.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. But to build a stable society, I always say that there has to be some good foundation. How
yes.
how the children are raised, how are the
exactly.
trainers raised, and of course economics come in. If everybody has enough to eat, for example, then generally people are satisfied. But if there's a hunger, but you were also saying that all these leaders were amassing wealth because some
that's right. I mean, they were amassing wealth that belonged to the people.
Exactly, yeah.
And also, as you well know, from an Islamic perspective,
yeah, right,
social
right.
justice,
exactly.
al-adal ijtimaiya, is a central theme
exactly,
in Islamic
yeah.
social and economic
That's
thought.
Right,
because
yeah.
Islam
yeah.
was not only about theology, it was about state and politics and all of that.
Right, yeah.
And let's say when the Prophet ﷺ came with the message, the Prophet cared for the poor because
absolutely,
that
absolutely.
His intention was not just to
yeah.
create a state or
exactly.
a constitution,
yeah. Yeah.
but to take care of the poor, and
yeah.
that's what he did.
Exactly.
And that's what we need to do in the 21st century,
exactly,
especially
yeah.
in the age of globalization.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Because
yeah.
Egyptian society, you know, Egypt is the most
yeah.
central state in the Arab world. It's very central in the Muslim world. It's very
right.
central in the world at large.
Right.
It's very strategic. It's located between North Africa and the Middle East, what
right.
we call the Middle
right.
East.
Yeah.
And also, you know, Egypt has been significant because of the rise of Arab nationalism
yeah.
under Nasser.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then the coming Sadat, the signing of the so-called peace agreement between Sadat and Israel,
yeah.
and
yeah.
all of these major factors that yeah. one has to take
and
account
once the
of.
Economic stability come, I'm very sure that the so-called terrorism, religious terrorism,
yeah.
intolerance between different faiths and then of course global should reduce, isn't it?
I think so that, you know, in times of economic prosperity,
yeah. Yeah.
you know,
yeah.
violence in a
exactly.
society or extremism will subside.
Subside.
And that's what we need to look at in the Muslim world.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah.
But of course, it's a big mistake to assume that violence is connected to Islam.
Well, yeah, of course,
because
no,
Islam
that,
has
that
presented a peaceful message.
Absolutely,
Islam
absolutely.
Has been globalized
absolutely.
In nature from the very beginning.
Absolutely.
Islam has always wanted to educate people.
Exactly, exactly.
You know, there's a famous hadith, "Utlubu al-ilma wa al-fasin," search
exactly.
for knowledge as far
exactly,
as China.
Yeah.
And this, as you know, if you look at this hadith, it is not limited to men,
yeah.
but men and women in
as
Islamic
well.
Society,
absolutely.
Which means that
absolutely.
Every mature Muslim man and
yeah,
woman
yeah.
must serve for
yeah.
knowledge,
and
even if
yeah.
they have to travel all the way to
yeah.
China in the
yeah.
past, which was very
and
difficult.
As we were talking
yeah.
off camera, that by the grace of Allah, MDA community is highly educated
yes.
because it's historically it's quite interesting, and it ties up with our theme that in British India at that time,
yes.
when the average clergy, average mullah declared that learning English is
haram.
Haram. Our at that time Khalifa
Khidr
al-Masih mentioned that no, exactly this was the point, and by the grace of Allah that is still encouraged.
Because in Islam, if you look at Islam, Islam has encouraged Muslims to learn languages and all of that. And you know, in the past, those prisoners who were not Muslim, they would be freed if they taught Muslims another language.
Because
that was very significant in the foundation of Islam.
So let's go a little bit into Libya. That's in politics of oil as well, especially in the Libyan context, although there are many Arab countries with oil supplies there. America is dependent, like other Western nations as well, on the oil. So what's this politics of oil? Is it that important? You are saying that Libya is located close to Europe as well, so of course, so a little bit of comment on.
Of course, you know, we can talk about the internal dimension, but also the external dimension of oil politics, that oil is very significant for Europe, because it's very close to Libya as well as to the States, and the whole world, not only Europe and the
That's
States. I don't know how much oil Libya used to sell, let's say, to the States, but Libya had been embargoed by the United Nations until like 10 years ago or so. But there's no doubt that Europeans are concerned about oil, but this is not their only concern. It's also the migration from African countries to Europe via Libya or via Tunisia or Algeria or Morocco, because that's a significant factor too. Also, I think that more or less in the post-World War II phase, Europe had been very much concerned about preserving stability in the Mediterranean, that's to say in North Africa as well, well as in the Middle East. So there's the oil factor, but there's also the migration factor and the stability factor. And as I said before, you know, one of the significant problems in Libya is that Muammar Gaddafi, in over 42 years of power, had not been able to build a unified vision for his own country and state. And I am very shocked at the divisions and polarization in his own country that appeared, you know, as a shock. I went to Libya once 5 years ago, and I said to myself, this is the first and last time I'm going to Libya, because it was such a dictatorial, it's very clear, it's a dictatorial regime. You know, because I love books, I went to bookshops, and the only thing I could see was the green book by al-Qaddafi. And I was given like 10 copies, but I have lots of copies too before I went to Libya, and I didn't want to read that.
So he has written a book.
It's called The Green Book, and then he wrote another book called The White Book. That will give, the Green Book is about the solution to the economic problems within Libya. The White Book is the solution to the political problems in the world.
So
it's like he failed at you know, at the local level, national level, and international level as well.
Well, in this context, I'd like to dwell a little bit about the role of Saudi Arabia. Of course, Saudi Arabia is so important in the Muslim world, both from its petroleum dollar, the wealth, and of course the philosophy as well. So what do you think? How
That's right. I mean, Saudi Arabia is very, has been significant because the holy places are in Western Saudi Arabia and Hijaz, where millions of Muslims go there on Hajj or Umrah every year, every month in Umrah in this case. So it has been very significant. It has been very significant because it is the largest oil producing country in the world. And that's why I believe that the U.S. has made a decision to stabilize the Gulf states. The U.S. or Europe or the world are not interested in seeing instability, especially in Saudi Arabia. They can tolerate instability perhaps in Yemen, but not in Saudi Arabia.
But have they been, Saudi Arabia have been able to build a stable education system, or teaching their children? Or,
you know, that's a good question. I mean, you know, modernization in Saudi Arabia began only 30 years ago or so, in the 1960s, 1970s. And most of the Saudi population has been born after 1980 in the past. So we have like, you know, 75% of the population has known perhaps the same king, of course the same family, because the same family has been in power since the 18th century. So I believe that Saudi Arabia has modernized its economy, but not in a healthy way, because the economy and the state and education, they're all controlled by the same family, Saudi family. So I don't see any political liberalization in Saudi Arabia. We might talk about economic liberalization, but not political liberalization. And it's very clear from an Islamic perspective that power belongs to the people, not only to one family or one tribe, but this is not the case in Saudi Arabia.
And I think for quite a bit of time, the same politics will stay there until the some sort of Islamic principles are followed. We did talk about
yes.
if the average people remain poor and the youth is not looked after. Although, of course, that's the journey of life that youth
you
has
know,
to understand.
The Saudi regime has the money to silence its own people.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'll give you an example. Before the tragic attacks on the USA of 9/11, a few Saudi students were sent by the government who were sponsored officially.
Right.
But after 9/11, we have thousands and thousands of Saudi students who go to the USA,
right.
who are totally sponsored financially by the government. They pay
right.
everything.
Right.
And we have roughly around 15 to 20,000 Saudi students in U.S. universities.
Really? Mm.
We have around 100 students here at the University of Alberta
right here.
Who are studying medicine and different sciences.
Mm.
And this is good, I believe. You know, this is about the globalization
exactly,
of education.
Yeah.
Yes.
We only have 2 minutes left. Sorry for that.
Yeah.
Quick comment on how do you see the future developing now? Egypt probably slightly settled. They're writing the constitution. Libya still... They are trying to get rid of Gaddafi. There was news that he's being persuaded to leave the country and
yes,
go somewhere.
Yes, yeah.
Tunisia is probably a little bit
well,
sad
I
right
see,
now.
Well, I see so much hope in the future of the Arab peoples and
right.
the Muslim peoples.
Right.
And I believe that, as I said before, that the youth who began to demonstrate and who
yeah.
started the uprisings, they had been patient for many years.
Right, yeah.
But because they could not take it any longer, in a sense,
exactly.
they began to vent
yeah.
their anger at the regimes
exactly,
and all of that.
Yeah, yeah.
And of course, they want to have a good present as well as a good future.
Right.
And that's why,
right.
you know, I trust totally in the youth as well
yeah.
as in
exactly.
the wise leadership
Absolutely.
Of Arab and Muslim societies.
Absolutely.
And I'm sure that Arab and Muslim societies are capable of producing good people
exactly.
to lead the nations,
yeah.
their
yeah.
own nation,
exactly.
into a good future.
Thank you very much. Really
Thank
appreciate you.
You
are able to
it's
come
a pleasure
and
to be on
talk
your program.
To us.
Thank you.
Well, this was the program Food for Thought. At least I learned a lot of interesting things. I'm not a politician in any way, but understanding what's going on globally around us is so important. And the important message is, even on this program, that if you have listened to the khutbah of Hazur Akhtas recently, he has asked every MD to understand what's going on and also focus more on prayers as well, and also examine ourselves as well. Whenever you see these global events, I think every individual has to take responsibility that, am I on the right track as well? Because as a society, then we could move forward individually, family level, and then of course national level and global level. Thank you very much. This is program Food for Thought. I'm your host, Mohiuddin Mirza. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.